but being faced at this point with what seemed to be an overwhelming adversary, which was the state, who had demonstrated to me that they had the power to confine me because I was placed in custody, who had shown me that based on whatever misidentification and evidence and my continuous assertion of innocence meant nothing to them. While in custody, trying to make sense of everything, it was a culture shock to me, being placed in this new, hostile world. Because prison is just a microcosm of society. And trying to understand and adapt and survive and trying to figure out how was I going to get home. I had no money. I had no way of even making my bail. My bail was what they call a ransom bail. I had a $250 bail, no 10%. So I was unable to make bail, so I had to sit. While in custody, he sent a public defender to see. Couldn't afford a private attorney, so a public defender came. Now let me add this piece to the story, because I'm going to walk you through everything. I had three public defenders within like a four-month period. I had three separate public defenders. The first public defender, he came to see me. Hey, how you doing? Hey, I'm innocent. I need to get out of here. I didn't know what questions to ask. All I knew was, I'm innocent. And I wanted him to believe me because in my mind, he was the person there to provide me with the resources and the avenues to get out. So he convinced me at that point, well, I'm going to do what I can. I'm going to do the research. I'm going to go shoot, and I'm going to get back with you. Weeks went by. They called me to court. I even refused to go in the courtroom because I didn't want to even dignify the charges. I said, I'm not going in there. I didn't do anything. So I was even arraigned sitting in the bullpen. If you don't know, the bullpen is we hold you in bars like a little jail section outside of the courtroom where you get your attorney come out and speak to you before you go in the courtroom. So I was arraigned, standing holding the bars while the bell held the door open, and the judge was like, how you plead? I'm like, not guilty, because I wasn't even going to win. And they were so frustrated with me. So months went by, they sent the second public defender to me. At this time, I was feeling the effects of being in prison. At this time, I was feeling the effects of being isolated, taken from society, now thrust into this environment where everyone seemed to have an anger issue. Everyone, I said, yo, what you in here for? I didn't do it. Oh, man, everybody say that. Like, it was like the Shawshank Redemption. Hey, Joe, what you in here for? I heard you. I was framed. He set me up. Everyone was saying that. And so for me, it became a quest to try to find a way to separate myself from that. The second attorney, I explained the same thing to him. He said the same thing. I get back with you. At this point, I was very frustrated. I want you to the third attorney I met. He was much more rehearsed than any of the other attorneys. With him, he had already spoken to the prosecutor. They had already met on a number of occasions about the case, which I had no knowledge. So when he came in to speak to me now, his whole mindset was, and you could tell, he came in, he was in assembly line mode. He had maybe 40 clients and like 20 some were in the bullpen with me, waiting to see him. So his mind was, I'm trying to reduce my caseload. I'm trying to find ways to close these cases out as easy as possible. I'm trying to, so he came in, his whole approach to me was, listen, Mr. Roberts, I really need to speak to you. All right, I'm all ears. The prosecutor said, they offer you a plea agreement. I'm like, plea agreement? Now, mind you, everyone said, I wouldn't plead guilty to a crime I didn't commit. I'd never do that. I stand up. I was out, same one of those individuals who who made that mantra that I would never plead guilty to a crime I didn't commit. I said that too. I often said it looking at Law and Order. Oh, I wouldn't do that. I often said it looking at Boston Legal. Oh, man, I wouldn't do that. You know, Denny Crane. I was of that same audience. But he came to me. And his whole approach to me was, Mr. Roberts, I'm trying to save your life. They got you. They got the victim out here waiting to testify against you right now. You were positively identified. They're ready to go to trial right now. You roll the dice, you're going to be in jail for the rest of your life. I'm like, the rest of my life? Now, I'm thinking, I'm laying out of fingers, I'm kind of on toes. I don't got that much. What are you talking about the rest of my life? And he's like, listen, this is only I'm trying to help you. They're going to dismiss this offense. They're going to dismiss the sexual assault, and they're going to downgrade the kidnap to second degree and put on a record no one got hurt, and we're going to give you 7 years, but you'll be home in 2 years, and I'm telling you, it's to your best benefit. And I'm saying to myself, that's crazy. I'm saying, what are you talking about? I mean, I'm standing there feeling like, like I often tell people, feeling like I have to make a decision between Lucifer and Satan. Which one of these evil was going to treat me the best? Which was the lesser of two? Because both of them would be evil, was wrong. I'll be forced to plead guilty to a crime I didn't commit or spend the rest of my life in jail innocent. So I'm faced with the impact of this, which is a very emotional feeling. It's an overwhelming feeling to feel that you have to save your own life. Because the law, first law is self-preservation. To feel like you have, wow, what am I going to do? I have my son, I got my family, I got my, what are the career things I want to do in the future? I'm seeing all that crumble. I'm seeing all my hopes, my dreams, things that I said that I was going to do, just got a nice apartment. All I'm seeing is these things crumbling. But do I want that to crumble for the rest of my life? So I started convincing myself out of fear, out of coercion, because one thing that I say, that the attorney who represented me, he should got Academy Award. His theatrical skills was amazing. He convinced me, he came in there, he was huffing and puffing, like, listen, like he was coming in with an urgent, like he was trying to say, like, I'm trying to help you. He laid it on so thick, I really felt, because he's my lawyer, and I thought that the lawyer in my mind was there in my behalf, so I trusted him enough to feel like he was the only one on my side. As a defendant, that's all you feel you have, is your attorney. So I listened to him. I'm saying to him, you know I'm innocent. He's like, man, in other words, stop that. Kill that noise. Stop saying that. Take this plea agreement. You'll be home in 2 years. You go down, prison, do a couple of push-ups, you'll be home. And I'm standing there like, why me? But I accepted the plea agreement. It took so much to fit in doing that, because I felt like I betrayed myself. I felt like I like let myself down, but I had to do this in my mind in order to save my life and preserve some of my future. And that's how impactful they had me thinking that the victim had. He told me that the victim had seen my picture and started crying uncontrollably. That they had everything laid out. So I reluctantly, out of fear, out of heartbreak, out of an attempt to save my life, accepted a plea for a crime I didn't commit. Now that sent me into a world tailspin. It had two effects on me. One, I blame myself for doing it. And two, I said I was not going to accept this 100%. I couldn't, a part of me was like, man, I don't care what you said. It was like I was fighting myself. Shut up. No, you better be quiet. No, you better not do that. It was like an internal argument I was having with myself. And I had that internal struggle going on for a long period of time. So I had to overcome the feeling of that of depression. I had to overcome that feeling of, you know, self-sabotage. I had to overcome so many emotions that are attached that the books don't tell you about, that happens, that you have to have. So I had to overcome all these things. So in my particular case, the problem began, other than what I just told you, the initial legal problem began when I was sentenced and sent to the Department of Correction. Now, prior to sentencing, they have to conduct a pre-sentence report on every defendant. The pre-sentence report basically determines or outlines the mitigated and aggravated circumstances that the judge is going to rely on, what he's going to base the sentencing code or sentencing range that he's going to sentence you. These things are just what the judge weighs. Unfortunately, one of the problems with the pre-sentence report is the probation department is who is assigned to do this, the pre-sentence report, especially in New Jersey and other states. The probation department doesn't have the luxury to have the transcripts at this point of the plea agreement, because you have to go in front of a judge and give what's called a factual basis. Even in my case, when I went in front of the judge, he didn't even ask me to say what I did. He just asked me a series of questions. Did anyone threaten you? No. Did anyone make any promises? No. Did you make this plea intelligently? Yes. Yes. Judge, I'm satisfied. I accept your plea. Because it was a trifecta they formed between the judge, the public defender, and the prosecutor, who I never met at this point. The prosecutor sat quietly. And the relationship that the prosecutor and the public defender had was a David and Goliath type of relationship. You had a public defender who was overwhelmed in caseload, understaffed, under-budgeted, competing against an office that has one of maybe the second largest budgets in the state, a massive staff, and a large budget and resources. So, when they formed this trial factor, but when I was sentenced and I went to for the pre-sentence report, the pre-sentence report didn't outline what I pled guilty to. It only reflected the circumstances of the police reports that said that I committed this acts, these acts, all the things that they said was dismissed was the pre-sentence report. So when I went in front of the classification department in Rahway Prison, is a classification was a committee of all the department heads, and they determine your housing status, they determine your custody status, your work status, your restrictions you're gonna have. When I went in front of them, they were like, so their position was, well, Mr. Roberts, you are guilty of this. I said, hey, I didn't do that. First of all, I didn't plead. That's not what I'm here for. First of all, I didn't do any of it, but that's not what I'm here for. At that point, that's when everything went extremely downhill. Because at this point, they start labeling me as being combative, someone who is in denial, someone who doesn't want to take responsibility. Right? So they were looking at me like, this is what the records say, this is what we're looking at, this is how we're going to treat you. I was sent to parole 3 times. Each time I was denied parole because I wouldn't plead guilty or admit to the events that they were reading from. I was what they call maxed out. I did complete 7 years. Full 7 years. Not the 2 years, but in that 7 years there, in that struggle to survive, I had 2 major things going for me. I had a lot of things going for me, but these things stood out. One major issue, major reliance, is I'm a God-fearing man. So I knew how to pray. I knew how to take it to a higher source, So that I was able to take some of the pressure off thinking I can do everything myself, because I couldn't handle it, it was too overwhelmed. And secondly, which is most important, is through my upbringing continuously, I knew how to read and write and comprehend what I was reading, which set me apart from a large portion of the prison population. Because the prison population, 90% of the population is illiterate. That's not a made-up statistic. That is a real statistic. 90% of the prison population can't read and write. You had one group of guys, it was like a little clique, and the guy was the leader of the clique, because he was the smartest, because he could write his name. So he was the leader. So he would read, and that was how sad the situation is. Being able to read and write, I started going to the law library. So someone told me about this guy named Uwakil. He was brilliant. Brilliant legal mind. He was basically a genius in prison. He had a life sentence, but he had got so many other guys out. He was so many convictions overturned, so many sentences reduced. I mean, his statistics were amazing. So I went to him. I asked him a question. Hey, man, what do I got to do to do it? And he answered my question. We should not have done that. When he answered my question, every time I seen this guy, I would ask him a question. Hey, I don't care if he's in a mess hall, which is a cafeteria, visit, yard, and where he's at. I would go up to him. Hey, man, he's like this now. Like, he used to tell people. And he see me coming, he tell his friends, this guy asked me what they were punching him right in his face. Tell you, So he got so frustrated with me, he gave me like a series of correspondence course, a parallel correspondence course. He was like, man, you read this, just to keep me busy. And stay out of his face. You know what I'm saying? Because he was tired of me. So I went in the room like a scientist. I was like missing for like 3-4 days. I had a little light. I'm eating peanut butter and jelly. I'm reading, and I'm absorbing everything I'm reading. So now, I come out, I'm more informed, and not only in criminal law, but I'm reading about torts, real estate, testing, business law, corporate law. I'm like, I'm amazed at myself, man. I'm like, you know. I got a few pins in my pocket now. Come on here, so now, then come back to him. He like, he said, well, tell me what I ran it down to him. Ooh, explained everything. Yeah, bro. He was like, whoa. He's like, man, you read, I mean, did you? He was like, he went back, was looking. He was like, give me my books back. He didn't give my stuff back, man. Let me get it. So. He got me a job in the law library as a clerk. So I knew how to type. Fortunately, I took typing in high school, because for me, in my opinion, all the pretty girls in typing. So I went to typing every day. But I'm learning how to type. So I had a typing skill. I didn't even know it was going to pay off to that way. So I'm typing. So my responsibility was to type their emotions in briefs. So that, they'll give me emotion, they'll write out the draft, I would type everything out. But as I'm learning, and also to get all the books from the prisoners want for their cases, so that taught me how to do research. It taught me how to shepherdize. It taught me about Westlaw, the key system. It taught me about the Nexus lessons. It taught me how to follow a train of thought. It taught me what was primary, what was secondary. It taught me what was the blue book, the book of citations. It taught me what was the Constitution. It taught me the three branches of the government. It taught me so much from just being in that position that I started helping other prisoners. Hey, man, you got an issue here. You might want to file this motion. You might want to challenge and file this motion. Well, why don't you do it for me? Why don't I do it for him? So I typed, and I followed, and I was having success because I had developed a very eloquent writing style. The acronym is KIS, keep it simple. You want to write less but say more. I had developed a style of how to write, not lengthily, but very persuasive arguments condensed. You know, not 20, my eyes was very, because honestly speaking, there's no judge going to read no brief this thick. They didn't even believe that. So you got to get as much and look, but that's going to, they're going to read the first. So I developed a technique and doing that and developing that, I became very popular. So people would come and I, you know, it became a passion for me. So I sought out higher education. I graduated from high school. Like I said, I went to class. All the pretty girls went to class. That's how they helped me graduate. I was like in class, you know, but my attendance was great. You know, so I kept a little, so I graduated from high school. So that gave me the opportunity to seek out higher education. So they allowed me to go to the University of South Carolina. I corresponded. And in those years, working in the law library, that's all I did. Day in, day out. Well, door open, I'm waiting at the door sometimes, my books. I'm running to the law library. That's all, like some guys, I'll tell everybody, got the best jump shot in the world, because that's all they did. Some guys got the best car players in the world, because it's all they did. Some guys go in the weight pile and lift every weight in that pile. Married to the weight, that's who they married to, because that's all they did. Some guys can sit around and just do nothing, because that's all they did. Me, all I did was go to the law library, and that was mud and work out, and you know, play football because that was a way to me get some aggression out and tackle somebody real hard. You know, so that was what I did. And while there in school, corresponded, I mean, it exposed me to so much information. But my case was developing. Now this was in the first 7 years. Unfortunately, for myself, on the day that I was scheduled to release, I went to the parole classes, I'm about to go home with this newfound genius, newfound intellect. New Jersey had passed a law called the Sexual Violent Predator Act. This law said that once you finish your sentence, if the state feel that you are still in danger, that they can confine you civilly for a lifetime. No new crime, just based on a set of statistics called the Stat 99, this chart that they rely on, that if you fit in this criteria based on this statistical chart, that you will either commit a crime in 5 years, or 10 years, or 15 years in the future. I'm like, man, you got a tool that can see the future, and you need to pick six, no, you were wasting it on 10 minutes, let's get some money. I'm like, what is going on? So, but they use this chart to say that because I refused to admit guilt, that I was still dangerous, that I was in denial. They even told me, because just once you're civilly committed, it's not a traditional civil commitment, it's a combination, it's a hybrid, they called it. But with the Department of Correction and the Department of Human Services, the Department of Correction responsibility was to hold you in custody care, but the Department of Human Services, mental health department, to provide treatment and therapy. So they sent me to this facility. Now, mind you, I had no idea I was going. I went to parole. I just knew I was going home. Everything, I'm standing there waiting with the rest of the guys going home. I hear them go home. Everybody out there waiting for me. They call their name. Hey, such and such, come on. He go, such and such, he go. I'm still standing in my back. They all gone. I'm still standing like, hey, man, what's going on? He's like, oh, I'm trying to find out. This is the day of my release. Oh, we gotta hold you. I mean, what you gotta hold me? I don't got no detainer, I don't got no other charge. I have no juvenile record, I have no other offense. What do you mean you gotta hold me? He said, listen, the Attorney General has submitted a petition to have you take to the civil facility. I'm like, man, what? At this point, I'm in a complete utter daze. No, but I can't, I don't want to make the situation worse by fighting and acting now, because I know I'm supposed to be released. I'm not going to sabotage myself again by doing something that's going to hurt that. So I said, when y'all take me there, man, I'm going to release me. We don't know. You're just going to take you there. They took me to this facility. It's called a special treatment unit. Now, when I get there, I'm like, man, I finished my sentence. They don't know. This is civil. Now, under this civil commitment, not like traditional civil commitment, because you're removed from the patient bill of rights. Do you have no rights? It's whatever they say, and that's how we go. So I'm here. They send me now in civil commitment under this act, you get a hearing called a commitment hearing. Now you have this hearing every year, but your initial hearing is to determine if they're gonna hold you. So you're there now, you're temporarily. So I was just there temporarily. That was enough for me. So they sent me the lawyer, public defender. Now it wasn't the same Rodney Roberts from 1996. That was like 25 years ago. I was a different Rodney Roberts at this point. So I'm like, listen, we're gonna do this. I want you to look into this. I need an investigation. This is what happened. I'm telling you what happened. This is true. I pled guilty to a crime I didn't commit. I'm innocent. You don't do what you don't wanna do. If you don't wanna help me, give me this discoveries, provide me, and I'm gonna help myself. He was like, well, you don't sound like the rest of these guys. He's like, something different about this guy here. So he took a chance. Him and his investigator went and found the victim. Took my photo to her house. Sat down and said, well, this is a guy. Is this a guy who you identify? He's like, no. She's like, no. I never seen him before in my life. Who is that? He's like, this Rodney, right? He's in custody for the crime against you. She's like, no, I never identified anyone. I thought kind of find out she hadn't even been to the police department. She didn't even know no one was arrested for the offense. All them years. All them years they told me, had me convinced that she identified me, that she was waiting out to testify against me, that if I was just, none of that was true. It was all fabricated. It was complete story, made up story that was concocted to keep me in the process of pleading guilty to this crime. Because guilty plea is like 95%, 97% of the criminal justice system is guilty pleas. That was a horrible statistic. But that's what they were. But come to find out, she didn't know. She was like, I don't know what this is. The lawyer was like, you gotta be kidding. She was like, you don't give a statement to that? She's like, yeah, whatever. I don't know. I never seen him before. So when he came back to me, he was looking at me, he was like, man, I don't know what to say, I'm sorry. Because she just said she never identified you. She just I told you, man. I was trying to tell you that. So I was ecstatic, because I thought that was enough to get me out. It wasn't. They granted me a post-conviction relief, pro se. Okay. What's the time limit? Oh, 5 years limitation. How could I get around that? Oh, excusable neglect. Oh, what is excusable neglect? Oh, that's when some kind of information and newly discovered evidence lies outside of the record. What case is that? Snake versus Mitchell? Oh, Snake versus McCoach? So I filed my own post-conviction leave. And the judge granted. He was like, sure, bring him in. In fact, we're going to give you an evidentiary hearing, which is a full hearing. Everyone was amazed. I just got confirmed before him. Brought in the victim, the attorney who misrepresented me, and a law enforcement, the detective who wrote the fabricated police reports. She got on the stand. He said, well, do you see the person in the courtroom today? I'm sitting right here. That assaulted you. She said, no, I don't see him. The judge like, what are you talking about? And Mr. Roberts is sitting right there. She said, I've never seen him before in my life. This is all the transcripts. I don't know who that is. So the judge, at this point, he seeing his career, because he made this mistake. Now, I often tell people that if you meet a judge that admit they made a mistake, you met some mythical thing. Like a unicorn or something like some 40, something that don't exist. you've met, because judges do not admit, they're just arrogant that way. They would not admit they made a mistake of this magnitude. So he mischaracterized her and started telling her, oh, you're untrustworthy at this point. Your credibility is not shot, because over years have passed now, and you found religion, and you were changing your testimony. She's like, I didn't change. I didn't even give you no testimony. I didn't even give you no statement. Well, how am I changing this? I never wrote anything or something. So they called the detective who did the investigation, who got the warrants against me, who claimed that she came to visit him and made a positive identification. He gets on the stand. This is what the lawyer said, well, did you just hear what she said? She said that never happened. Oh, it happened. I don't understand why she would do that. Well, she signed the photo. Where's the photo? Oh, we can't find it. It's gone. So what do you mean? So there's no way to authenticate what he's saying. Now keep that piece in mind. In between, they asked for a DNA test. I said, well, I want a DNA. Now, because the lawyers believe me, because they just talked to the victim. So they kind of, they like, so this is 2005. So I took a DNA. They took some to the state lab. The results of that DNA was I was excluded. However, it came back inconclusive because the materials that they had in storage for her had degraded to a degree that they were unable to positively identify if it belonged to her. So what they needed was an updated swab to compare. So we asked them in 2005, the state, for the additional test that was done, the kits that were done. They said, we went, claimed, came back, we can't find it. What do you mean can't find it? It's gone, we don't know where it's at. They sent two investigators to look for it. They came back, we can't find it. Look again. We don't have no idea. In fact, we don't know where his records are. They had to come re-fingerprint again because they had lost everything. Of course, they were doing it like this. That's how they had the fingerprint. Because I was refusing to give them in, but I had to give it to them. But they had lost everything. So they're saying this, for years, we have no way to test the DNA. But the higher court, the appellate division, who reversed three times, I had three reversals. So as a result of the evidentiary hearing, I was denied, the judge denied. Said, no, I didn't make no mistake. I weighed all the evidence. There's no way in the world I could overlook this. You know, I'm all knowing. It's impossible. And denied it. Me, filed a notice of appeal. Appellate division set my appeal. They assigned me a appellate counsel who was an excellent attorney. The best appellate attorney I've met. Thomas Hands is the name. He got me, I did my pro se supplemental brief. He did his brief. We won. Sent it back. Now, the victim, she said that as a result of her assault, she had a son. So I said, can I take a paternity test, please? Let me take it, because I want to just demonstrate that by any means that I'm not the person. So they grant my order to take a paternity test. So I took the paternity test, swab, you can't swab me, swab her, swab the son, sent that to the state lab. That, in turn, gave the state lab the additional information they needed to continue with the previous DNA examination, with the degraded part they had. The appellate division got wind of this. I don't know how somebody got wind. I don't know who did it, but they got wind of that result. They wrote such a scathing roadmap opinion against the state and the judge. They were like, listen, there are some serious questions of Mr. Roberts' guilt in this case. We want y'all to examine the DNA further. In fact, at this point, because I have been denied continuously in lower court, they have reassigned me a judge and a new attorney. So when I come back this time, they signed me Michael Pasicali. Michael Passacaglia, in turn, went, and lo and behold, the evidence they said was missing pops up 9 years later. 9 years later, they find this box. Now, the box was like this big. How you miss it? Oh, we mislaid it. A big box. But I was not mad. I was happy because I know that now I'm about to come home, but something's about good about to happen for me. So they sent the evidence to State Lab. State Lab did they laboratory thing. The doctor, because they're scientists, the scientists there concluded that Mr. Roberts is excluded as a candidate. He's not the individual. DNA does not match. At that point, I was exonerated. At that point, that report changed everything. Because they called him in, and I don't know if you know, scientists are arrogant. How dare you question? The prosecutor was like, are you sure? He was like, how dare you question my he was like, who do you think you are? You know, he was really upset. So he stood his bed. So as a result, the judge vacated my conviction. I'm going to tell you, when the judge said, Mr. Roberts, I'm sorry for what happened to you. There's nothing I can do to bring them years back, but all I can do is fix it from this day forward. When she said it, now I'm standing there and I'm in like a tranquil moment. I'm like, because I'm here when I'm here, but when she said we could overturn your conviction, all I heard was my mother and my sister and my love was out there. They was over there having the Holy Ghost. They had the free church. Because they stood by me all them years, and believe me, they was my support. They was the ones who dealt with the ridicule. They were the ones who went past and coming in to visits and having to subject themselves to going through metal detectors and being treated unfairly and hostile towards them. They dealt with all that all them years because their loved one was there and they knew I was in them, especially my mother. She was not going anywhere. It was one time they kicked out the courtroom because she wouldn't stop answering questions. That ain't my boy. He didn't do that. I know how I raised, who my child raised. They're like, ma'am, you cannot say nothing. They ask a question, dude. No, he ain't do that, not my kid. Not my child. They're like, we got to fish wild. You know, so they had to wait out in the hallway because she would not sit there. But when she heard that, that was hers and that was theirs. So the judge could do nothing but let them have that. Let them have that relief. So, you know, that's when I started crying. You know, I was trying to be all thugged out. I'm crying. It was, you know, it was such a moment. You know, I wish I could capture that feeling and put it in a bottle. It was such a moment to feel vindicated. So, however, even having my conviction vacated, I was in the civil facility. You know, so I had to wait and go through the process of dealing with just having a hearing. So they took me back, and they said to me, Mr. Roberts, wait, be patient. We got, listen, I tell you about only thing he ain't my song, that Beyonce song. You must don't know about me. I filed a pro se motion for speedy trial or dismissal of all charges. Lo and behold, it went right back in front of the judge who just vacated my conviction. And what the state was trying to say was we were trying to wait to see if we were going to retry. You do know this DNA. This is DNA using. There's no second guessing this. She dismissed everything. All the charges, all the. Sent the notice. I thought from there, back to the law court, I'm going home. So then, the civil commitment lawyer said, oh, you got to wait until we have a civil commitment hearing. They go that song again. I filed a pro se motion for an accelerated civil commitment hearing. Sent it right to the judge chamber. He got it. Within 3 days I was in front of the judge. He said, I got everything. I know everything. I got all the paperwork. They called, the judge called me. He said, I can have you out here in 2 days. That next day, they called my name. Robert! I like to broke my leg. And so when I was terrified. So my family was kind of picking me up. They were like, well, when you come out, we're going to take all these pictures. You're walking. I'm like, you better not turn that car. Open the door. I'm going to dive in. Get down the street. And that's just what we did. So we got to jump in. Everybody outside like, bomb. Whatever. I'm free now. So we get out of the street. We jumped up out. Yeah. Everybody ride by. Look at that. What's going on? Yeah. We were celebrating. So that was March 14, 2014. Now, that was 17 years later. That's a teenage life. Gone. That's a whole generation that don't know me, that I don't know. That's a generations of tech-swabby, brilliant minds coming up with all this new technology that's looking all far. I think I'm like in a Star Trek movie. What's going on? My phone. I got a hat. He gave me a phone. The phone started making noise. I thought I broke it. The phone was just how smart it was. I'm like, man, when I left my phone, when I had a GED. How come on your phone got college education? So I had to learn how to catch up on the different technology, which I was so far behind. You have 70 years is a long time. And you don't know how much longer you've gone. I didn't know how long I was gone, so I came home and see how far back I was and trying to catch up with cultural differences, the cultural change, the change in society, the change in norms, some of the customs that change, traditions are no longer things, you know, like giving a seat up on a bus. For me, that was a pride thing. You get up, you see a woman come in or a child come in on a bus, you get up, get your seat, hey, you go. That was gone. I'm sitting there and she would get up, give her a seat, she was looking at me like, what you trying to do here? I'm like, no, you can sit down and say, no, I'm all right. Yeah. I'm like, wow. So I had to, although I would never lose chivalry, because that's just how I was raised. I have six sisters, and, I saw in a lot of women and girls in my family, so I would never lose that sense of chivalry, because that's just who I am. I live by that principle and tradition. But it didn't fit in as much as it used to. So you have to be selective. You know what I'm saying? Because chivalry is not dead. I always often tell women chivalry is not dead. It's just women stop demanding it. So I'm still dead stuff. But that was just one aspect. And just the adjustment was difficult. I don't want to sugarcoat this. I thought coming home was going to be the all solution to my problems. I thought it was over. I thought it was, at this point, I'm free. I'm free mentally, spiritually, emotionally. I thought now I was, and I have been, but the issues and the difficulties I ran into with employment, because in New Jersey and a lot of other states, they don't have compensation or wrongful conviction agencies. They just don't imagine that they would make a mistake and put an innocent person in jail, I guess, or create circumstances for a person to put, be pressured into plead guilty to a crime they didn't commit. They didn't factor this in. So it wasn't a way I could go for housing. It wasn't a way I could go for help me with financial, with treatment and therapy, because you can't just go through all that experience and not. So I was sort out these things. So I had to find a way to adjust back into society without those things. Now, New Jersey has their compensation laws, which recently changed. They raised the amount you get compensated from $20,000 to $50,000 a year for each year. However, they wrote a clause that if you plead guilty, they're not going to give you your compensation. Even if the lawyer coerced you, even if they demonstrated that he was ineffective as a counsel, even with DNA, they were willing to fight me. So I had no real resources other than my wit and my mitts. And a passion in my heart, and I was out here now to do the right thing. Because my prayers were, Lord, if you get me out of here, I'm changing my life. You already know. I'm gonna be a part of the solution and not the problem. You already, and he heard my prayers and did his part. The doors flew open and I'm out. Now I, in my heart, had an obligation to my commitment and to him. That no matter what, I was gonna stay on the right path and do the right thing, and no matter how difficult it got, that I was gonna continue to be positive, continue to help, continue to be a part of the solution, not let what happened to me destroy me, make me bitter, make me angry, make me turn against and have an adversary relationship with society. Like, you know, like I said, I meant that, and I mean it today. But it's difficult, it's been difficult, because even in employment, I wasn't able to get a job, get work. Because my counterparts was guys on parole and probation. And they was hiring them before they hired me. I'm like, man, I'm on probation. I'm exonerated. They was like, well, let me be honest with you, Mr. Roberts. We in the money-making business. One guy told me, he said, I get tax deduction, extra income tax deduction for every guy on parole I hire. So I need that money. You're a great guy. The story is amazing. I'm really sorry that happened to you. But I'm not even sure that 17 years you've been gone, you could do the job. You had this big gap in your work history. That became the mantra. So for me, that was heartbreaking. However, I said to myself, well, if you can't find a job, at some point you gotta have to create one. You have to do something. You have to feed yourself, you have to do these things. So I was fortunate to be introduced and link up with another exoneree named Jeffrey Deskovitz, who had spent 16, 17 years wrongfully convicted, exonerated, and he had won his compensation. Nice compensation, very handsomely. He took a portion of his compensation and started the Jeffrey Deskovitz Foundation to help exonerees reintegrate and to fight for other individuals who are innocent of prison. So he brought me in and his staff in New York and Manhattan. Mundane office. My job was to go through the files and look through discoveries and determine viable candidates that our staff and our office was gonna review and take on to help with exoneration. He assigned me two interns from Columbia University. We, lovely young ladies, we, in turn, we had a different idea. Myself, I had a different idea, because I was like, party, party, party. I was like, you know, I came home, like, let's go have some fun. So we would go out to events, fundraisers, and we would be like the life of the party. We'd be running around the table, talking to everybody, hey, how y'all doing? You ever heard of Jeffrey Deskovitz Foundation? They'd be sitting there looking, smiling. We had fun. We was like the lampshade on your head. Crap. So everyone started inviting us to come to the party. So they come to the fundraisers. Bring your cars. Come here. Tell them. So we took the office from like a quiet office to like a social, like social life. We were like a social. So the Jeffrey Deskovitz Foundation got a different popularity as a result. We did great work, man. We did our job. But we wanted to take it outside of the office and meet people and talk to everyday people and ask them how they felt about wrong conviction. Ask them how they felt about prosecutorial misconduct. And ask them how they felt about judicial misconduct. And the response was amazing. That, in turn, helped me get in line and in touch with and part of an organization called It Can Happen to You, which was an organization based in Albany, New York, who had drafted a bill to create an oversight committee, a prosecutorial oversight committee. Now, bear in mind, prosecutors have complete immunity, both in their individual and official capacity. So that means that the Bar Association has some limited guidelines that they have to follow, but by all means, prosecutors have authority in the courtroom. And they get to withhold exculpatory evidence, which we all know, evidence, and you have behavior on two forms of evidence, inculpatory and exculpatory. Inculpatory evidence against you, exculpatory evidence you can have. They can withhold exculpatory evidence and sit on their dresser. Sit on their desk. Evidence. That evidence in there 10 years. Let me get around. I need to clean my desk off. Yeah, I had it. Yeah, I found it. And there's nothing to really do to them for that. There's no accountability. So the bill that they sponsored was a bill to create an oversight committee in New York. This committee was be like a judicial oversight, because judges even have oversight. Prosecutors have none. This committee will sit and determine, based on the level of the violation, how egregious it is, to determine the sanction against the prosecutor. If the prosecutor is going to be sanctioned or censored or suspended or disbarred. This is what they were asking, that there be something there to keep them in line from just going too far, because they had all power in the courtroom, even over judges. We fought the bill, we in and out the Senate, in and out the House, I mean, all the others, in and out, telling my story, meeting senators, we had great bipartisan support, first of all. Different legislators, councilmen and women, I was in and out of every office. So the first year of the bill, we had great impact, we had great momentum, but it came behind the rent control bill in New York. And I don't know if y'all know the rent in New York is a big thing. So when it comes to rent control, any other bill that comes behind that is done. Because by the time that they finished with that, it became a lame duck Senate. But we came back the next year and got met with some great opposition from the prosecutor. They had, by that time, they was aware of us, and so they fought hard against us creating any oversight. They don't want no oversight. They don't want nobody to be watching them. So in that passion and doing these things and being a part of public awareness and bringing greater awareness to prosecutorial misconduct, bringing greater awareness to how the situation would happen, with someone such as myself could be forced and put in a position to plead guilty to a crime I didn't commit, to bring greater awareness of ineffective system counsel, to bring greater awareness of the injustices that happen all the time, you know, that go unnoticed, to be a part of talking about mass incarceration, which people start thinking is a phenomenon that began today. Mass incarceration didn't start today. Mass incarceration really started with the passing of the 13th Amendment. 13th Amendment is the abolition of slavery. It says slavery, no involuntary servitude, shall be permissible in this country, except when you're duly convicted of a crime. So once you're duly convicted of a crime, whatever duly means is reduced to the status of a slave. Black, white, candy stripe. You know anyone. That's how it applies. Everyone. So you found the prison complex, you found laws being created that create a prison complex. Because now they had that same cheap labor base that had wandering. Oh, what you doing out here past this time? Oh, lock them up. And then you find them on the chain gang. You know what I'm saying? So mass incarceration started in 1865. The first real prison, first prison was greater for prison in Philadelphia. It was a penitentiary. It was created and started by the Quakers. They would send those in the community who were a little absent, a little in the community, away for penance. They would seek penance. They would isolate them. It's thus the word penitentiary. That's where the word came from. So, but it was never meant to be the punishment that you've seen in death. But what happened was they developed it, and then you've seen incarcerated prisoners or prison-type facilities industry pop up everywhere, because you had, as a result of the 13th Amendment, all you had to do was convict someone of a crime. Now you have someone you have as a servant, and who is completely disenfranchised. Because you have, once you're convicted, you have all your rights are stripped as far as right to vote. The basic Bill of Rights still applies. You know, you still have those, some of the tenants, but you basically detach from those rights and your citizenship, and to a large degree. So to talk about that, to bring greater awareness to these things, to be a part of sharing this information, to be a part of coming in the classroom and saying to you that you are the future, your minds are important, your role is important, especially today. Especially today, because the youth are the energy. Y'all are the movement. And I want to be someone who puts a real face on a real problem. It is a problem that an everyday citizen, it can happen to anyone, can be falsely accused, falsely arrested, wrongfully convicted, spend years in prison, innocent, and then find out later that they were innocent all the time. You know how widespread this phenomenon is now? You can turn your TV now and see it almost every day. Such and such just came home, he did all this. And then they have now discovered those individuals on death row. Spent 20, 30 years on death row, innocent. That's like a devil whammy. I'm like, what? I'm looking at them, and I'm innocent. I'm looking at them, I'm like, wow, I really learned. Because they were on death row. Their life was like, we're going to execute you. And they're saying I'm innocent. That's how serious the problem has grown. Now, in those who take on roles of public service, you're going in office, in certain circumstances, you're going to counter those mindsets that are only interested in career, their career, and advancing their career, no matter who feet they step on, who back they step on. That is prevalent. But in today's society, we need those minds that can take a step back and say, you know what? I graduated from law school too. I passed the bar too. So I can make my own determination also. If this evidence shows that this individual is innocent, I'm not going to be a party to withholding. I have an obligation as well. I have rules of professional conduct that I have to follow as well. It may make me unpopular. It may make me them not want to speak to sit at the table, but ethically, I can live with myself, and because I chose this profession as a public servant to seek justice. That takes a lot of courage in pursuing a career. It takes a lot because to separate yourself from the group. It's difficult in high school now, because you know how it was in high school. Come on, to separate the popular group and to do you. So we didn't act like we haven't seen that before, but imagine that 100 times more impactful. That's what we face with. But we need those courageous minds that think outside the box. We need those minds that you have. I come way up from New Jersey. I came here to speak to you because I want and I know that y'all are the future. And if I can do anything, whatever I can do, any part I can play, is just to give you something on the opposite side of it. At least you can say, I met someone who was just happened to. So it's not like it's not real. At least you have something on the other side to compare it to. In telling this story, I want to thank you, because she just told me I had to go. No, it's good, because I'll be here all day. I want to thank you, and it's an amazing experience. In closing, I would like to say, for years I spent in prison thinking no one cared. Oh, they don't care out there. That hopelessness, oh, they don't care. But to come home and see how wrong I was, and see so many people do care, it humbles me.